Welcome, my dear learners, for this course on control engineering. In this module 2, we were discussing on block diagram reduction and signal flow graph. So far, we have solved two new problems on block diagram reduction. Continuing our discussion, moving ahead, the problem number 3 of our discussion on block diagram reduction states that determine the transfer function C of S by R of S for the block diagram shown in figure. So now, we are heading to determine what is the effect of system parameters on the input to produce the desired output, which is nothing but transfer function. I want to find the transfer function for this block diagram. One more very important note I want to make for problem number 3 is that, so in problem number 3 we are encountering the critical rule, that is rule number 7 will be used to solve problem number 3. So as I said, always we should try to shift the takeoff point in front or behind the block, or the summing point in front or behind the block. Only if and only if there is no other choice, we can't move without shifting the takeoff point behind or in front of the summing point, then only we should do that. Otherwise, we always try to move the summing or takeoff points in front or behind the blocks only. But in this case, a careful observation reveals that there is no other choice, that I should come out of this complicated block structure. So therefore, I want to shift this takeoff point in front of this summing point, or I want to shift this takeoff point behind the block and then behind the takeoff point, behind the summing point. So there are two choices. One choice is the first one, shifting this takeoff point in front of the summing point. Second choice is that I can shift this takeoff point behind G2 and then shifting it behind the summing point, and then I can interchange the takeoff points. Now, before solving the problem, first you should check, visualize how the problem will proceed. So if I use the first step, what I said, if I shift this takeoff point in front of the summing point, I will come here and I can interchange these two. But what I observe is that G2 will come in between the two summing points. So now I cannot apply any of the rule. So neither I am getting the blocks which are in parallel, nor I am getting the minor loop. So if I check for the second one, what I explained, that is shifting this takeoff point behind the block shifted, and again if I shift this takeoff point behind this summing point, then I can interchange these two takeoff points and move forward. So however I do, I want to shift this takeoff point behind or in front of the summing point. There is no other choice. I can solve this problem in both the ways and check whether I'll get the same answer or not. Let us do that and verify whether I'll get the same answer or not. Let me do first by shifting this takeoff point behind the block and then behind the summing point and solve for case A. For case B, I'll shift this takeoff point in front of the summing point and solve, and I'll check whether I'll get the same answer or not, and I'll explain what happens if I make a move by shifting this takeoff point in front of the summing point, or if I make a move by taking this takeoff point behind the block and then behind the summing point, which will give us answer faster and in less number of steps. Let us verify that. So let us have the solution for problem number 3. If I solve problem number 3, as I said, in step 1, rewrite the problem by splitting all the takeoff points and summing points. A careful observation reveals that none of the takeoff points or summing points are clubbed. All have been splitted up. So therefore, rewrite the question as it is in step 1. So we have the input signal R of S, and we have the summing point for which we have a negative signal minus H1. And then we have block G1, then we have a takeoff point having the block G3 to the summing point. Here also I am having the summing point G2, I have the takeoff point coming here minus H2, and we have the output signal C of S, and we have H1. So this is what we have. Now what I will do is that I'll shift this takeoff point behind the block and check how the problem proceeds. So in step 2, I'm shifting this takeoff point behind the block. So therefore, step 2 will yield us the answer as we have the signal R of S and we have the summing point for which we have the negative feedback minus H1. We have G1, then we have the takeoff point G3, then we have the summing point. Now I am shifting the takeoff point behind G2, so therefore I should add G2 to the feedback. This you people already know how to shift the takeoff point behind or in front of the block. Whenever I shift the takeoff point behind the block, I should add the block value to the feedback. If I want to shift the takeoff point in front of the block, then I should add the inverse of the block value to the feedback. So since here I am shifting the takeoff point behind the block, I am adding the block value to the feedback. So I'll get G2. Next, we have G2 and we have the summing point. We have G3 with positive sign. Very, very important. And from here, we have H2 moving out. C of S having H2. So this is what I will get in step 2. Now observe carefully that I want to shift this takeoff point behind the summing point because there is no other choice to solve this problem. So therefore I am shifting this takeoff point behind the summing point. Whenever I am shifting the takeoff point behind the summing point, I should retain the summing point with the same signs. So this you people already know in our critical rule. So therefore step 3 will give us, since I am shifting the takeoff point behind the summing point, add the summing point with the same sign for the feedback line. So what I will get, we have R of S, we have summing point with the negative feedback. So these two are in series, hence I will get G2H1. And now we have the block G1. So I'll shift and interchange. So I'll shift as well as I will interchange them. So if I do that, I'll get the summing point is added with the same sign. So the sign of the summing point is negative. You can observe here we have a negative feedback, so I retain the negative feedback, and then we have the takeoff point for G3. We have the summing point with negative feedback, and later we have G2. And then we have the summing point, and then we have the takeoff point C of S. So here, so we have, we should add the summing point with the same sign with the feedback to the feedback takeoff line. So therefore, so I am adding the takeoff line with the same summing point with the same sign with the feedback as H2. So this is what I will get at the end of step number 3. Now, in order to move forward, I should split these things. So we have one feedback coming from the main line as G2H1. We have one more feedback coming from the main line as H2. We have one more, that is from the exit, from the output. We have H2 minus 1 G2H1 to the input. So totally we have 3 feedbacks. So this is the first feedback, this is the second feedback, and this is the third feedback. So in order to clearly analyze, let me split all these 3 feedbacks. So because of this minus sign, I'll add minus 1 as the feedback value for the negative value minus. So what I mean to say is that let me split all these 3 feedbacks. If I split the 3 feedbacks, what I have, I'll get in step 4 as we have the input value as R of S, we have the summing point, so for which we have 2 feedbacks coming to this. So therefore I split into 2 summing points, you know, to understand the problem better. So one, the bigger one, that is coming from here through H2 minus 1 coming and goes here, so which I can write it as G2H1. Because of this minus sign, I'll add it as minus 1, and we have H2. So this is comes from the end point, correct? And now here we have minus, here also we have minus. I splitted it twice because we have one here and we have one coming like this. So therefore I written 2 summing points. I splitted it 2 times. So moving forward, I have G1. Next, we have one feedback left out because I taken the longer one and rewrote it. So we have left out with only one feedback now, that is G2H1. And next we have like this G3 to the summing point plus, and next we have one more minus, we have H2 left out, that is also for main line. We have block G2 lying in between these 2 summing points, and this completes step number 4. So hope you clearly followed. So totally we have 3 feedbacks, 1, 2, and 3, from beginning to ending. So in order to remove this summing point in the takeoff line, I have added minus 1 here, you can see. So thereby I eliminated this summing point. So I splitted all the 3 feedbacks properly and wrote it. So now the clear picture is that, so this is a minor loop, so I can close this. And also here, you know, to solve, either I should shift this summing point in front of G2, or I should shift this summing point in front of this takeoff point. Always I said, always avoid shifting the summing point in front or behind the takeoff point, or takeoff point in front or behind the summing point. Always try to shift in front or behind the blocks. So therefore I'll shift this summing point in front of this block G2, and also I'll close this minor loop. So what I said is that I'll shift this summing point in front of the block G2. So here I have three moves I can make. One is that I can shift between these two. That is, shift this takeoff point in front of this summing point. Second option is shift this summing point in front of block. Third option is shift this summing point in front of this takeoff point. As I said, as much as possible, we should avoid the critical rule, that is shifting between the takeoff point and summing point. So therefore, I'll shift this summing point in front of the block. So if I shift this summing point in front of the block, since we are shifting the summing point in front of the block, I should add the block value itself for the feedback. So therefore, this feedback line will added with G2, and also it close this minor loop. So if I do that, step number 5 will be. Now moving for step number 5. So we have the input signal R of S. And we have the longer feedback coming from the before output. Since all these three are in series, I can multiply them. So if I multiply them, I'll get the answer as minus G2H1H2 minus G2H1H2. This is what I'll get. Now I want to close this minor loop. We know that the minor loop, this is a minor loop because we have only one block in the forward path, only one block in the feedback path, and one summing point and one takeoff point. So therefore, close this loop. We know that formula for closing the loop, this is nothing but the canonical form of the block diagram. The answer is G of S divided by 1 plus or minus G of S into H of S. I should use positive sign if this is negative. I should use negative sign if this is positive. Since I have negative feedback, I should use 1 plus G of S into H of S in the denominator. If I do that, I will get G1, that is G of S divided by 1 plus G of S is G1 into H of S is G2H1. G of S divided by 1 plus G of S into H of S. Done. I close the minor loop. Next, we have one takeoff point for G3. One takeoff point for G3. And we have one summing point. Now I am shifting the summing point in front. So therefore, I should add the block value to the feedback line. So I'll get G2 here. We have one more summing point. And this has a feedback of minus H2. Since nothing is present here, we can write the value as 1. Now, to avoid confusion, I am adding the value as 1, or I can interchange that. Now we have feedback from main line H2 and the longer feedback. So this is what the problem looks like. We have C of S. This is what I got. Now I can interchange these two. We know that if I interchange the summing points, it does not make any difference. That is our first rule which we have discussed. So therefore, step 6, I'll interchange these two. We'll get R of S. We have the summing point, we have the feedback, and then we have the block value as G1 divided by G1, G2, H1, and then we have G3 G2 So I'm interchanging the summing points. Before that, when I shifted, I have not added G2 to H2. So G2 should be added to this line. Sorry. Because we have shifted the summing point in front of the block. Whenever we are shifting the summing point in front of the block, block value should be added to the feedback. So these two are in series, so therefore this will be G2H2. That will become G2H2. I am interchanging the summing points. I got G2H2. So this is what left out in step number 6. Here I have minus G2 H1 H2. Hope you followed. So now we have one minor loop. So this is one minor loop. Since here we don't have anything, which means that we have unity in the forward path. One we can take in such cases. If nothing is there in the forward path, we can take the block value as 1. Similarly, in the feedback, if nothing is there, we can take the block value as 1. So therefore, this is one minor loop. I can close this. And these two are in parallel. We know that for parallel, it is just sum or difference. Since I have plus, it is G2 plus G3. So if I do that in step number 7, I end up with R of S. We have the summing point, we have the feedback, we have minus G2 H1 H2, and then we have G1 1 plus G1 G2 H1. This is in parallel, so therefore we have G2 plus G3, G2 plus G3, and this is a minor loop. So if I close that, I will get the value as G of S is 1 divided by, since I have minus sign, I should use plus. It is 1 plus G of S is again 1, H of S is G2 H2. So we have the feedback and the output as C of S. Now all these three are in series, so therefore I can multiply all these three. So hence multiply all these three, you will get the canonical form of this block diagram. Finally I can get the answer. So therefore step 8 will yield us the canonical form from which I can get the final answer. We have the negative feedback as minus G2 H1 H2. Here the block value will be G1 G2 plus G1 G3 divided by 1 plus G1 G2 H1 into 1 plus G2 H2. So this is what I got in the step 8. So this is of the canonical form. We have only one block in the forward path, only one block in the feedback, one summing point and one takeoff point. We know what is the transfer function. Do it. So if I solve, the final answer will be, we know that the transfer function is C of S. Transfer function is output C of S by input R of S, which is equal to g of s divided by 1 plus g of s into h of s, that is g1, g2 plus g1, g3 divided by 1 plus of g1, g2, h1 into 1 plus g2, h2 whole divided by 1 plus again g of s. G of s is g1, g2 plus g1, g3 divided by 1 plus g1, g2, h1 into 1 plus g2, h2 into h of s. H of s is minus g2, h1, h2. So g of s divided by 1 plus g of s into h of s. So if I take LCM and cancel off denominator, so now to take LCM, I should multiply this to 1. So throughout I can write this, so and cancel off these two. So if I do that, I'll get the final answer as g1 of g2 plus g3 whole divided by 1 plus g1, g2, h1, g1, g2, h1 into 1 plus g2, h2 and we left out with plus into minus is minus, minus g1, g2 plus g1, g3, that is g1 of g2 plus g3 into g2, h1, h2, g2, h1, h2. So this is the value of denominator. So 1 plus g1, g2, h1 into 1 plus g2, h2 plus into minus is minus g1 of g2 plus g3 into g2, h1, h2. So I continued here. So what I stopped here, I continued in the next line. Now, if I simplify further, I'm going to get that is, we have the transfer function solution as transfer function, we got the answer as g1 of g2 plus g3 whole divided by, so let me multiply these two. I have 1 plus g1, g2, h1. I multiply these two inside. So 1 into 1 is 1 plus g2, h2 into 1 is g2, h2. Plus into plus is plus. 1 into g1, g2, h1 is g1, g2, h1 plus g1, g2, h1 plus into plus is plus. We have g1, g2, h1, g2, h2, that is g1, g2, g2, h1, h2 plus g1, g2, g2, h1, h2 minus, let me write it here itself, minus we have g1, g2, h1, h2 multiplied to g2 plus g3, that is g1, g2, g2, h1, h2, g1, g2, g2, h1, h2 plus into minus is minus. We have g1, g2, g3, h1, h2, g1, g2, g3, h1, h2. A careful observation will reveal that these two will get cancelled. So therefore, the final solution for the transfer function is, for problem number 3, we obtained it as g1 of g2 plus g3 whole divided by 1 plus g2 g2 h2 plus g1 g2 h1 minus g1 g2 g3 h1 h2. So this is the solution for problem number 3. Now, as I said, we can also solve this problem by shifting this takeoff point in front of the summing point. So in solution A, we started the problem by shifting this takeoff point behind the block g2, and we shifted then the takeoff point behind this summing point and solved. So I'm a student who thinks differently, that I want to shift this takeoff point in front of the summing point in the first go itself, because I'm good in solving critical rule. So therefore I'll choose solving the problem by shifting this takeoff point in front of the summing point in the first step itself. Let me see if I do that how the problem proceeds and verify whether I will get the same answer or not. Now, as I said, if I move for solution B, that is step 1. So due to space constraint, I am not rewriting the problem once again in step 1. In step 1 directly I am proceeding the problem, that is I want to shift this takeoff point in front of the summing point. So this is what I want to do in solution B. So now to do that, if the careful observation is that the takeoff point has to be shifted in front of this summing point, but for this summing point we have the input as g3. So therefore, as we know from our critical rule, whenever we shift the takeoff point in front of the summing point, we should add the summing point to the takeoff point with the negative sign, with the opposite sign. Whereas if I want to shift the takeoff point behind the summing point, then I should add the summing point to the takeoff line with the same signs. But here I want to shift the takeoff point in front of the summing point, so therefore I should add the summing point to the takeoff line with the opposite sign. Here I have plus, I should add it with minus. So since I want to have g3, so I will write g3 below and h2 above for convenience. So if I do that, I'm going to get, we have R of S, we have a summing point, we have input minus feedback, then we have G1 in the forward path, and we have G3. I want to take this G3 below and shift this H1, H2 above for convenience, for better understanding. And next we have minus should come here. Next we have G2. Now I am shifting the takeoff point in front of the summing point. So therefore summing point should come first and then the takeoff point. And finally we have one more takeoff point, and then we have output C of S. This is what I have. Now if I write it properly, G3 should be connected to this summing point. No worries. I want to connect G3 to the summing point. So therefore, I'll take G3 and connect it to the summing point with positive sign. So since I have shifted this takeoff point in front of the summing point should be added to this takeoff point with the opposite sign. So the takeoff point as H1, so therefore this should have the one more signal from this. I should add a summing point with negative sign, because we have Here we have positive, hence I am adding the negative. Opposite sign is added. So this will come to H1, that is the beginning summing point. H1. And then we have H2 to the last takeoff point. We have H2 to the last takeoff point. Hope you clearly followed. What I did is that I have shifted H2 above and taken G3 below. This is because of the reason I want to add this summing point to this takeoff point H1, since I am shifting the takeoff point in front of the summing point. And since I am shifting the summing point, takeoff point in front of the summing point, I should add the summing point to takeoff point with the opposite sign. That is what I have done. Here I have plus, here I have minus. So hope you clearly understood. If you have forgotten, you kindly visit lecture number 1 and revisit the critical rule, that is rule number 7. Now let us solve this problem. If you carefully observe, let us clearly write by splitting the signals properly. As we all know, signal can't move opposite the direction of arrow. Signal always moves in the direction of arrow. So therefore, first observation is that after G1, signal moves like this. G3, one will go to summing point, another will go to this summing point and come back with the feedback H1. So therefore, first let me resolve this one. G3, go to the summing point, come back with H1 to this one. So G3 with the negative sign will be added to H1 in this loop. So first one will be, we have R of S, we have the summing point with negative sign, and also one more signal is coming from this takeoff point with just H1. So therefore, to this summing point we have one signal like this and we have one signal like this. Hope you understood. One signal is G3, the summing point, and H1 will come here. Another one is direct, we have just H1. So since two signals are coming for this, I'll write it separately in order to avoid confusion. I wrote it as twice. One is as usual, H1 is coming, I'll retain H1. Another one is G3, instead of the summing point I should replace it with minus 1. This you all already know, which I clearly demonstrated when we solved solution A. So here I have H1, instead of the summing point I should add one more block of minus 1 here, since I have minus here, and then we have this signal G3 coming. G3. So all this come in front of G1. Hope you understood now properly. After G1, G3, instead of this summing point, replace it with the sign, that is minus, hence it is minus 1, and H1 we have. So next we have the summing point. We have the feedback H2 coming. And then we have G2. One more observation is that from this takeoff point, one more signal is going to this summing point. It is just G3. G3 is again going to this summing point. So therefore, here I should take one more takeoff point, because from this takeoff point we have two signals. One is G3 minus 1 H1, another one is just G3 to this summing point. So let me write it more clearly. We have one more signal, that is just G3. This one, just G3 to the summing point. in front of G2 plus, and we have takeoff points. So it is just H1. So therefore this takeoff point is with reference to just H1. And then we have one more takeoff point, that is C of S. So hope you people understood. I have clearly separated the signals properly. So for this, two signals are coming, G3 minus H1, and one more is direct H1. So separated, I wrote it twice. So I wrote it G3 minus 1 H1 and H1. And here two signals are going from here, that is G3, one comes to H1, another one, just G3, goes to this summing point. So G3 comes to this beginning summing point, and just G3 goes to this summing point. So I clearly separated by writing the summing point and takeoff point twice. Hope you understood clearly. This is the reason I told, try to avoid using critical rule whenever it is possible to avoid it. So this is what I said, it will become a bit messy. So you should carefully observe how the signals are flowing and separate it properly and carefully. So now the problem becomes simpler. Now we can solve it easily. So this is just a loop, correct? So this is just a loop. So therefore this I can solve directly. Here I will get minus G3 H1, G of S is G1. So therefore G of S by H of S. So hence step 3 will become, solve this one completely, this loop. So if I solve that, I will get R of S. We have H1 coming. So this is completely solved. It is G of S, that is G1 divided by 1. Here I have minus, I should use plus. Let me use plus. Again G of S is G1 into H of S is minus G3. H1, that is G of S divided by 1 plus G of S into H of S. Done. So next, if I go here, I want to shift. Let me shift this summing point before G2, and then I can interchange it, correct? Let me shift this summing point before G2. So if I do that, then it will become G3 by G2. Or I can shift this summing point in front of G2. If I shift this summing point in front of G2, this will become H2 G2. So whichever is convenient we can do. So since it will become a product if I shift this summing point, let me shift this summing point itself in front of G2. So if I shift that summing point in front of G2, if I shift this summing point in front of G2, so I'll get G2 here. Since summing point is shifted in front of the block, block should be added to the feedback line. That is, we have minus, add the block G2 to the feedback line, and then we have H2. So now I left out with one more summing point for which the takeoff is G3 with positive sign. Hope you understood. Just I have shifted this summing point in front of G2. So therefore G2 should be added to this H2 line I have added. Now we have takeoff points. So for the sake of simplicity, let me interchange these two takeoff points. Interchange these two takeoff points, and I have shifted this summing point in front of G2. Hope you are following. So since I interchanged, it will come here itself. So from the beginning we have H1, and later we have C of S. Now I can interchange these two and solve. I can interchange these two. If I interchange these two, this will be in blocks which are in parallel, and this will be a loop. So therefore step 4 will be we have R of S summing point negative, we have the block value as G1 by 1 minus G1 G3 H1, G1 G3 H1, and next we can interchange the block, hence it will become G2, here I have G3 added to the summing point, plus I have interchanged these two. And then we have negative with G2 H2. So if nothing is present, which means that we have unity here. This you people already know. So in the forward path, we don't have anything, which means we have a block of unity. Same thing holds good for feedback also. So now we have the feedback as H1 and we have C of S. So this is solved. These two are in parallel. So the block value is G2 plus G3. G2 plus G3. Here we have the minor loop. The minor loop value is G of S is 1 divided by 1 plus 1 into G2 H2. G of S by 1 plus G of S into H of S. So if I solve all these three are in series. So just a multiplication of this. So the final canonical form will look like this in step 5. In step 5, the final canonical form is R of S minus we have H1. So G1, this is G2 plus G3. Here the G of S is 1. So therefore it is G1 of G2 plus G3. G1 of G2 plus G3 whole divided by we have 1 minus G1 G3 H1. 1 minus G1 G3 H1. So here it is nothing. G2 plus G3. So it will get multiplied. Here it is 1 divided by 1 plus G2 H2. So it is 1 divided by 1 plus G2 H2. So this is the value of forward block. And we have the takeoff left out to H1. Output is C of S. So this is the canonical form of the given problem. So now I can find what is the transfer function of this. G of S divided by 1 plus G of S into H of S. So if I do that, I will get the transfer function answer as so therefore the transfer function will be G of S is G1 of G2 plus G3 divided by 1 minus G1 G3 H1, 1 minus G1 G3 H1 into 1 plus G2 H2, 1 plus G2 H2 whole divided by 1 plus G of S into H of S. G of S is again this one, into H of S is H1. So you'll get G1 H1 of G2 plus G3
divided by 1 minus g1 g3 h1 into 1 plus g2 h2.
Now what I do is that I'll take this as LCM and cancel off the denominator. So if I do that, I'll get the transfer function value as g1 of g2 plus g3 whole divided by, since I take LCM, this should come here. So it is 1 minus g1 g3 h1 and multiply this inside. Multiply this inside, you will get plus g2 h2 minus g1 g3 h1 h2. So 1 into this, 1 into this, g2 h2 into 1, g2 h2 into this, will become g1 g2 g3. So minus g1 g2 g3 h1 h2. So this is g1 h1 g2 g1 h1 g2 plus g1 h1 g3 plus g1 h1 g3. So this is what I will get if I take LCM. Just I took LCM, cancelled off the denominators, multiplied the products. Just I multiplied the products. So 1 into 1 is 1, g2 h2 sorry 1 into 1 is 1, minus of this into 1 is same thing. Now g2 h2 is multiplied to 1, g2 h2 multiplied to this one, minus g1 g2 g3 h1 h2. Now here g1 h1 is multiplied to g2, g1 h1 is multiplied to g3. Just I took LCM and multiplied the products in the denominator, that's it. Now if I simplify, a careful observation reveals that g1 h1 g3 will get cancelled. So therefore the final transfer function what I got is g1 of g2 plus g3 whole divided by 1 plus g2 h2 plus g2 h1 g1 g2 h1 minus g1 g2 g3 h1 h2, g1 g2 g3 h1 h2. So this is the final transfer function solution I got. So earlier we got g1 g2 g3 1 plus g2 h2, g1 g2 h1 minus g1 g2 g3 h1 h2, exactly same. So from solution B also we arrived at the same answer. From this I wanted to prove that the block diagram problems does not have unique way of solution. The final solution answer is same, but the procedure is not unique. It depends on the students how they think. So this solution we arrived when we started shifting this takeoff point behind the block and proceeded. So this solution when we arrived after shifting this takeoff point in front of this summing point. So therefore the procedure varies from student to student. It's very important for you people to remember the 7 basic rules of block diagram reduction and use the critical rule whenever there is no other choice other than using the critical rule. Otherwise we'll end up with the steps which are somewhat messy like this. Carefully you should observe how the signal flows, split it properly and show it, then only you can solve the problem or move forward. So that's all from this lecture. Thank you all.